Kubernetes resources, I'll just skip everything here, which is not so relevant. So we have a lot of AWS accounts. Anybody saw this Lyft announcement? I think this was the beginning of the year, where they badly prepared for the IPO and had shared their badly AWS spendings. And it's, I think, impressive how much they spent. But the question is really, when you look at this cost per Lyft ride, right? Lyft is like Uber, or I mean, Lyft is not in Germany, but you probably know what Lyft is. So 14 cents barely per ride goes to AWS, right? So now you might question yourself, okay, is this a good price or not? Is this a good unit economics or not? So it's not really what we can answer here, but we can at least talk about how to optimize resource requests and latencies with Kubernetes if we run Kubernetes. So this is only really relevant if you're on the cloud, because otherwise you still have your on-premise hardware. So who runs kind of on the cloud? Probably most of you, but no, it's just minority. So anyway, in the end, I think there is this magic dial between speed and actually cost savings. And it really depends what product you have. If you don't have any customers, you probably don't want to go for efficiency and cost savings, because you need to validate your product first. So my key point here is, first of all, it's not only just getting the last bit out of cost efficiency and spending, but it's really about the trade-off stability, speed, and cost efficiency. But let's skip all the really basics, or at least look quickly at it, because there's not so much time for me. Kubernetes is all about resources. So you, in the end, you have demand for resources. So the workload demands, I need some capacity to run. And you have nodes who offer capacity. And of course, you have the key normal resources, CPU, memory, but there are also more exotic resources like local ephemeral storage, extended resources, GPU, etc. And you want to manage this demand versus offering. So how is this declared? Probably nothing new for you if you use Kubernetes, right? So for CPU, you usually use a unit of vCPU or whatever it's called on your cloud provider, or like Hyperthread on-premise. And usually use something like millicores. So 100 millicores would be 0.1 vCPUs. And for memory, you use, of course, something like byte. And you don't use bytes normally, but like megabytes or maybe bytes. And that's how you define resources in Kubernetes. So that's all the basics. And the important part about Kubernetes is actually that it's kind of complicated, because you don't only have CPU and memory, but you also have two different things to define. You have requests and limits. So who here is really familiar and says, like, oh, I grab how this works, requests and limits? Anybody? OK. Then maybe you can come in front and give the talk. But badly request and limits, and this is, I think, for newbies to Kubernetes, a little bit tricky to understand. That there's this major difference, that requests are really here for the scheduling decision, and limits are really for limiting the usage of your containers. And yeah, so there are some side effects from this. So because I did this with a slide share, I have to just like peek at my own slide, so sorry for that. Requests are really used for the scheduling. So you have these two nodes here as an example. You want to schedule something. There are already pods on the nodes. And if you want to schedule something, then of course it needs to fit. Okay, it just fits on the node. All fine. There is another pod I want to schedule, but this doesn't really fit anymore. So what happens here is that if you don't have enough free capacity on your nodes, then you get something like a like a pending pod, sorry. So this pod would be pending because it doesn't have enough capacity on any node. If you use cluster autoscaler on a cloud, then usually this is the point where it triggers the autoscaling of the cluster, so it would add a new node. But anyway, so the important part is requests define how much badly capacity you use per pod, and they block capacity on the node. So this is important to understand. So if we want to optimize cost, for example, we would need to optimize requests, so we use less and block less capacity on nodes. There are some side effects. So first of all, and this is, I think most people don't know this, CPU requests on Kubernetes have a side effect of defining CPU share. So if you do use Docker run, then you also have this option CPU shares. And this actually, what this does, it's relative priority. So if we barely use this kubectl run with some CPU request, and this is like two different runs, so with 10 millicores and 5 millicores, then we can go actually to the C group. So the C group is the underlying kernel feature. And see, okay, this requests 10 millicores and this requests 5 millicores. And when we now run something, so like just the arbitrary workload, in this case it's just a hashing function, just burning some CPU cycles, then you will see, I mean, this will look different on your laptop, but you will see that barely the 10 millicores, right, yeah, it's a little bit fuzzy, but it will barely use double the CPU time. So the CPU requests also define in congestion mode, so if you barely run something really burning CPU, then something with double the CPU request will have like kind of double of the CPU time. Okay, so this is important to know, because this will come back later for us. So CPU requests define how much capacity we block on nodes, but also have the side effect that it's relative priority for the kernel scheduler to badly define if there are two workloads with the same demand, that it gets kind of more CPU. So limits, there are different kinds of limits. So there are compressible limits. Compressible means that we can take away this easily, right? So CPU, we can always squeeze more out of CPU, right? It's like kind of, we can just, some things will run slower, but we can always try to get more out of it. And we can at least throttle CPU. So CPU limits will throttle your workload. So if you define 200 millicore CPU limit, what this actually means is, and this is also a common misunderstanding, 200 millicores doesn't mean that I get, or one core, as a simple example, one core doesn't mean that I get one core. It means I can use one CPU second per second. If I use 200 millicores here, then I say I can use 0.2 seconds of CPU time per second. So if you define, for example, two cores, then a lot of people think, okay, I get two cores. Like it's like I have my laptop with two cores or four cores. But this is not true. You barely define that you can use in 1 second 2 seconds of CPU time. That's what you're saying. You can still use, if you know it, all the CPU cores if you don't use CPU pinning. And this is important to know, I think, because it's like one core in Kubernetes doesn't mean one core, like a hardware core or VM, but it actually means 1 second CPU time. Okay, so let's see how this work look like. Here, just for simplicity, I use this with Docker. So a Docker run has also the CPU option, and basically Docker is also the default runtime for Kubernetes and uses C group, so you can try this all out without Kubernetes. So all these features are actually not a Kubernetes thing, but C groups. And you can barely just try it out with CPUs. And here we define, like my workload is just a hash function again. Okay, I'm a Python guy, so I'm just importing hashlib and do some CPU burning. And what I now do is barely I run this and time it for different CPU values. So barely running this Docker run command with CPU is one, takes 3.8 to 4 milliseconds. Okay, this varies, of course. I run this on my laptop. And then if I go down and barely use only half the CPUs, then, of course, takes longer. So you see it spikes to 50 milliseconds already. And then if I go down to 1/10, it takes up to 190 milliseconds. So here, of course, expected, right? Lower CPU limits will get more throttling, so our workload will be slower, will take more time. But it's important to see that this 0.1, this is 1/10 of this one core, but it will not take 10 times as long, but much more potentially, right? You see it's spiking to 190 milliseconds. So it's like, it's not like kind of, you know, linear between like time taking or throttling and your CPU size. But the important part is CPU throttling will make us slower, as the name says. Then, so this was CPU limits. Then we have memory limits. And memory is hard to take away, right? So memory holds state, so we cannot just like compress memory and get more out of it. At least, I don't know a way of how to do it right now. So this is the famous OOM killer, right? So we will, if we reach the limit, we will be killed, because it's the only way how we can regain kind of this resources. We cannot compress it. So how does it look like for memory limits? you would usually see something in your pod like crash loop back off, and if you then describe your pod and see the last state, you will see something like OOM killed. This is, I think, a very common picture you see for a lot of people, at least in Zalando. So we have 1,500 developers, so I think like most of them saw some OOM killed at some point. So memory limits, you will be killed if you reach the memory limit. So definitely look out that you have the memory limit high enough. There's another tricky point in Kubernetes. There's something called quality of service. Anybody knows quality of service in Kubernetes? This person needs to know it. He raised their hands earlier. But quality of service is something a little bit tricky, and I think this is historically a wrong decision. But based on your requests and limits in Kubernetes, how much you request, you have a different behavior. So there are three quality of service classes for pods in Kubernetes. Guaranteed means all containers have request equals limits, so the same values. Burstable means the containers have a higher limit than what they request. And a best effort is value you have nothing set. So best effort you probably never really want to use. Burstable might make sense, so meaning you barely have a higher limit than you what you request, so you can barely overcommit, right? So you barely reserve less capacity than you potentially could limit, so you barely are optimistic that this will work out, right? And this barely defines the C group hierarchy. This sounds a very low level, but this is important in some tricky failure situations where the C group hierarchy defines what happens. Also defines OOM score and so on, but like I just wanted to mention it that you heard of it, quality of service. And you can check it in the pod. You see this quality of service class if you describe the pod. So I already mentioned quality of service and overcommit. If you have limits higher than requests, then you have this burstable quality of service. And this depends on what kind of you overcommit. If you do it for CPU, this should be fine because we can always just like try to get more out of the CPU. For memory, this is kind of dangerous. So imagine you have all the different containers on your node now barely overcommitting, double the memory they barely then really need. Then this means if everybody stays below, then it's fine. But if they barely go and exceed this node capacity, then this is dangerous because you get this not the OOM killer for your container, which is kind of the good thing to protect the rest, but you get the OOM killer from the kernel on the node. And as you probably know, I don't know, anybody experience OOM kills on the kernel? It doesn't kill what you want it to kill, it just kills what it thinks it's best. And this could be your kubelet or your Docker daemon or whatever, but it's probably not the workload which was really affecting this. So memory overcommit is potentially dangerous. So just a quick look at CPU or C group limits in general. So you can find this all out when you go barely on the sysfs and C groups. So you find CPU shares, the period and quota, and then the memory limit. But this is only low-level details, but you can barely like find out how this works. So CPU limits have a major problem, and this is, I'll talk about this in a minute, is latency. You already saw like this was spiking to 190 milliseconds for this hash calculation, which was not really expected. And memory might also be dangerous if we overcommit because of this node out of memory. So latency, we were also pretty late to discover this. So badly we created this, or commented on this Kubernetes upstream issue. There are, I think, two at least. How the CPU limit is implemented in Kubernetes is, I told you earlier, this is one second CPU time per second. And how it works is that they do accounting, right, on the kernel, C groups. And for this accounting, you have a period. And this period was hard-coded to 100 milliseconds. This is still the value, the default value in Kubernetes. And this means the whole CPU limit accounting is done on this 100 millisecond window. And now you can imagine in this 100 millisecond window, and you say, I want 1 second of CPU time per second, you could actually use, and this barely means 100 millisecond per 100 millisecond, right? If you use this 100 millisecond window, you could use this 100 millisecond CPU time already in the first 10 milliseconds. And then you don't have any CPU time left in this 100 milliseconds because you might use in the first 10 milliseconds already all the CPU time. So the period is hard-coded in Kubernetes. This is no longer true. We did an upstream fix. But this means you always have 100 millisecond window, and this might be affecting your latency. Monzo, the UK bank, is really great. They also do this great failure talk. Basically, they had a fork of Kubernetes where they changed this value to 5 milliseconds. And this 5 millisecond window basically allows you to not have this huge latency spikes anymore. And yeah, we fixed it upstream. So this is about the window. So the window, I think, easy to understand, right? If you have a 100 millisecond window and you do this for accounting, you could use this 100 millisecond in the first 10 milliseconds because of threads, et cetera, right? And then you have to wait 90 milliseconds. But there is another problem with CPU throttling. So this is really hard to read, I think. But here you see this limit is a blue line. And the usage is a green line. And there is a red line, which you cannot see. The red line is throttling in a percentage, so it's the right y-axis. And you can see the usage never reaches the limit, but the CPU throttling goes up to 100%. So this is unexpected, right? So you say, like, oh, I give my workload 3 vCPUs, and my usage is like only 1 vCPU. So how is it? Why is it throttled all the time? Quick test. You can try to do it on your own. So we have 100 millisecond CPU period, and we just burned 5 milliseconds of CPU time and then sleep 100 milliseconds. We don't expect any throttling because we don't have any quota, so no limit on CPU. That's fine, right? We see burn took 5 milliseconds. Next test is the same. We have 100 millisecond period, which is a Kubernetes default. We have a quota of 20 milliseconds, which basically is, high enough to not be throttled because we burn CPU time for 5 milliseconds and then sleep 100 milliseconds. We can never reach 20 milliseconds of CPU time, right? So no throttling expected. But if we now look at the CPU time here, we see 5 milliseconds and then 99 milliseconds, 5 milliseconds. So there is high throttling of CPU on this workload, but this is unexpected because we should never reach this 20 milliseconds if we just burn 5 milliseconds. Now, just a quick test with a smaller quota, right? Smaller window to do accounting. And we still expect throttling, or we now expect throttling because we burned 5 milliseconds and have a 2 millisecond quota. But what we can see, yes, we are throttled, but you see there is no latency spikes to 100 milliseconds, it just goes to 80 milliseconds. So this is barely proving what I said earlier. When you have a smaller window, you can barely avoid this high latency spikes. And if we look at this 90 milliseconds, I don't know what services you operate, but 99 milliseconds can be a lot in a microservice environment, right? So you don't want to get a latency spike of 99 milliseconds just because cgroups doesn't work as expected. So this is an incident, which is part of my talk tomorrow about failures. But you can see here is we reduced the limits. So the blue line is limits. It's really hard to see. The red is the throttling. And here it explodes, and basically kind of our workload is stuck with CPU throttling. So we can even have incidents with CPU. OK, I skipped this. So what we learned on KubeCon Copenhagen is actually that Google, at least Vish from Google, recommends disabling CPU throttling. So this is what a plot twist for us. We try to reduce this period to basically have a better accounting. And this is what we did. So we avoid memory overcommit in Zalando, and we disable CPU throttling in our clusters. So there's a flag in kubelet to disable CPU throttling. And this works great for us. Remember, I showed earlier this request is affecting relative priority. So even without CPU throttling, you will still have kind of higher requests, can use higher CPU. So you still have like weighting of your workloads. And latency goes down for Ingress. OK, I'll skip this all. I think, I don't know, if I only have like a few minutes. So auto-scaling, et cetera. Just wanted to show something quick. So what we see as the major thing to improve for cost efficiency is something I call Slack. So this is, again, the node. And we have usage, and we have requests. And the difference between usage to request, right? So imagine you request 2 gigabytes of memory for your workload, but you actually just use 1 gigabyte of memory. Then this 1 gigabyte would be Slack, because you barely pay for it, but don't use it. And this is actually can be kind of pretty big. So what I created this little tool which shows you the slack and the costs. So barely you can go in this case through teams and say, okay, who is actually causing the most slack in our environment? And this is just generating HTML into this little GitHub project. But this is basically what I see as actually when we look at cost efficiency and resource optimization as a big lever, is just reducing slack. Basically making people aware that they should tune requests to their actual usage to not waste money on slack. So there are a lot of more like pages here. Just skip this. There's another tool from me. This is just for playing around, but this is something which helps for reducing slack. And in the end, you don't want to tune all these values in YAML by hand, right? You want actually the machine to do it for you. So like Tim Hawkins says, like in Google, 2/3 of the engineers use the Borg autopilot. And Borg autopilot, what it does is actually you don't set this request, but it just automatically finds out what is the request for your workload. And what it's called on Kubernetes is VPA, vertical pod autoscaler. So you have horizontal pod autoscaler, right? And vertical pod autoscaler is basically changing the request to match your workload. And what we use, it's not really, you shouldn't use it for critical apps because it will restart your containers. But what we do is actually we have 130 clusters and we use a VPA, for example, for Prometheus. I don't know if you run Prometheus, but Prometheus, you need to scale vertically for memory. And we don't want to tune 130 clusters. So we barely use this vertical pod autoscaler to scale Prometheus vertically. And so it works. But don't use it for critical apps, VPA, but it barely avoids you setting those values manually in your YAML file, this resource request. And yeah, this is how it looks like. So this is the usage, right? And here's the memory, the VPA adapting the request and limits. And as you can see, it's not perfect, but it works for my test apps and Prometheus. Yes, here another example of vertical pod autoscaler. As you can see, it always like it uses the last 24 hours for their history, and then as you can see here, for example, here it scales up the requests and limits because for some time it was barely over the threshold. So it's like, of course, you would as a human probably do it differently, but it works fine for our workloads. So try out VPA, but not for your critical customer-facing apps. Horizontal pod autoscaler, of course, you probably already know about this. Usually, or by default, you can scale on CPU and like the core matrix, but you can also scale on custom matrix. We created a little like matrix adapter you can use, so you can scale it, for example, on queue length if you have workloads processing something from SQS or some arbitrary Prometheus queries. There are also other projects out there, and there's a nice blog post about this. Just another trick to scale based on like demand. We have a lot of test clusters and a lot of test apps, right? And usually we work during office hours for like testing things manually, maybe, or like trying staging. And Belly, for this, I just created this little downscaler where you can scale based on time frames. So it's you see on the weekend everything is scaled down and during night. So you can here you see all our clusters. So there's one cluster which is an exclusion, but everything else scales down on the weekend for test. You also might have a lot of accumulated waste, right? So this is another thing for resources where you might waste. Yes, you probably know prototypes you deploy and never clean up, and this is money. So you want to delete stuff after a few days. You want to have temporary deployments cleaned up, and you want to remove resources maybe without the owner. And I created another tool which is called Janitor here, where you can barely define TTLs on arbitrary Kubernetes resources and also have custom rules. So, for example, you can deploy your PR with a TTL of whatever 24 hours, and then it's automatically deleted. Or in our case, for example, we have a rule when there is a certain label missing, it's automatically deleted from test clusters. So badly, you can just try something out like Nginx without anything for a demo, but then it's, if, even if you forget it, it will be deleted. And this is how easy it can run, right? If I would now do a demo, I can just do run Nginx and then add a TTL, and that's automatically cleaned up again, and I don't have to care about it. And now I lost the focus. Yeah. Yes, you have also custom rules, but this is not so important. And another way is, of course, optimizing spot on EC2. It's not so much about optimizing Kubernetes resources, but as you can see, you can at least save 72% of money. Just a quick run on overhead. So we have a lot of cluster, and you want more clusters potentially, because this is like smaller blast radius. You don't have to vertically scale the cluster components. Just to compare the different overheads, right? The cluster has some overhead because of control plane. GKE is free, very good. EKS, you have to pay $146 per month for the cluster control plane. And we actually pay $600 per month for our like overhead master nodes. Of course, this can be optimized. Just a recap, disabling CPU CFS quota works for us, and more companies actually do this. It doesn't, yeah, just check if this is the right thing for you, but MyTaxi now did this, for example, and yeah, other orgs I'm in contact with. Memory overcommit is not the best way to go, and barely showing the slack to teams and how to optimize this also helps. And then in the end, you are free to dial where you want to be on this efficiency versus speed and stability. Yeah, everything is open source, and that's already it. There are some good talks about this, so if you want to know more, there's one good by Michael about inside Kubernetes resource management. It's more in detail about this resources requests and limits. I would definitely recommend you, if you just heard this talk now and don't really know what requests and limits are, then look into more detail, because it's important to understand, I think, and this is not really well described in the Kubernetes docs. Yes, that's it. Sorry for being the filler for like whatever you wanted to hear. Nothing about Ansible.